Tomorrow we will take the group picture. It would be at 4 p.m. So right after the 3 p.m. talk, we can all go together from here to the terrace at the third floor. So this is the second floor. We have to go one floor up, and then we take the picture there. Okay? So for the last talk of the day, oh, and I also would like to remind you that after his talk, there will be the cocktail here outside. So everybody is invited. And for the last talk of the day, we have Harald Helfgott from, let me see if I remember, CNRS, UCA, and Göttingen. And he's going to speak about sophistry, short cycles, and the Higman group. Okay.
Yeah, so this is joint work with Kate Yushchenko. Well, a brief reminder before I start stating anything, just setting some notation. So sim n, I like to write it that way. It's just a group of all permutations, of course, of n elements, the so-called symmetric group. And the Higman, the Huffman distance, which is the only distance they will be using, is defined for any two elements of the symmetric group as the number of elements at which they differ, divided by n. It's a normalized Huffman distance. Can everybody read this well? Should I write very well? So it's a number of places at which they differ. No. So the distance between something and itself is, of course, zero, and the distance between a permutation and a permutation that differs from it at all places would be one. Very well. Given that, the following concept is due to Gromov, and this was redefined the following equivalent ways by a member of the audience. So let G be a group. So I would like to state it in the following finitary way. So for n, a positive integer, delta and s finite, an s delta n sophic representation is quite simply a map from sim n. No, from S to sim n, it's finite set S, such that the following two rules are obeyed. So first of all, this map should be what is called an approximate homomorphism, meaning that, well, phi g composed with phi h, well, I like to write things this way. This means just phi h. I mean, this is the same as this. This does not have to be identical to phi of gh, but it has to be very close to it. And I don't ask for this to be true for all elements of g, but for all elements of s, rather. All elements of s such that their product is also in s. Otherwise, the thing on the right would not be defined. So this is a rule, or the approximate homomorphism rule. And then there's the second rule, the distance of phi of g from the identity is large for all g in s that are not the identity. So this would be phi of, let us give it a name, phi of g has few fixed points. So unless g is the identity, of course. So Gromov had originally a different name for it. I think it was initially subaminable, or very well. All right. So somebody here came up with a better name. That's good. And the definition that I can state here nicely. And we say that the group is sophic if there is such a representation for every S and every delta, no matter how large S is and no matter how small delta is. There is such a representation, phi, for every finite S and every delta greater than zero. So finite groups, you know, and for some n, some n that depends on them. Yes, this should be D. Thank you. Very well. So it's clear that, for example, finite groups are trivially sophic. It's not hard to show that several other families of groups are sophic, amenable groups are sophic, and so on. But then people get sort of stuck. We know how to show that certain families of groups are sophic. Then there are other ones for which we have no idea. And in particular, well, and what is most important is we do not know that there are non-sophic groups. I think most people suspect, and perhaps I should ask for your opinion, most people suspect that there are plenty of non-sophic groups, but we don't know a single one of them, and we don't know that they exist. You don't have an opinion. I know. Unless it's trivial, yes. Yeah, but it might be trivial for some super Gromov being, yes. Very well. So collective goal, collective objective, sounds like crap. Not yet fulfilled. Should make this clear since I'm calling it an objective during a talk. No non-sophic, construct or show the existence of a non-sophic group. Very well, and the goal of this talk is more modest. It's to discuss a candidate. And we will show that if this candidate group, well, I will break the secret, the Hickman group. If this candidate group were sophic, then something really strange would happen. But we have not been able to show yet that that's impossible. No, and we will also talk about, I will also talk about some connections to number theory that will be sort of obvious, and to recurrence. Very well. So a definition, what is this funny group, the Hickman group, which was constructed as a counterexample a while ago, about 50 years ago, counterexample to something else. So let HM be the group generated by M elements satisfying the following rule. When I conjugate IAI plus 1 by that, I get this. For, well, where this is understood modulo M, so to speak. So by I plus 1, I actually mean 1, for by M plus 1. So this rule is also satisfied for I equals M, where by M plus 1, we actually mean 1. So it cycles around. So H4 is called the Hickman group. If you wonder what's so special about 4, well, what happens is that H1, H2, H3 are all trivial. Yes, but everything I'm going to say today would also be true for H5 and so on. We see obvious changes. So I will leave some space for a definition that will make what I'm about to state stronger. So let me state CRMA, and then I will so use pencil, because I'm going to make this statement stronger in a minute. So assume H4 is Sophic. Assume this Higman group is Sophic. Now, then, there exists, no, for every epsilon and for every k, let me say for every n first, and every, for every epsilon, there exists an n and a bijection. F z n z to f n z, such that it has the following two properties. So the first property means that f is locally like an exponential map. So this is true for a proportion tending to 1 of all elements of Zn mod nZ. And number two, the fourth power of this map is identity. Looks pretty unlikely. Now, let me make, you might ask me, well, if I admitted no exceptions, could I prove that this is false? Sort of. I could not show that this is false, but I can show. I could show, or other people have shown, that a statement very much like this one, which we have also proven, would be false. What would that be? What would that statement be? Well, we know that if you become less tolerant, this leads to a contradiction when n is the fourth power, or the fifth power of a prime, excuse me. If we can assure that n is the fifth power of a prime in this statement, and we can. So a sequence, an increasing sequence of positive integers, we will call it thick. It doesn't take much to be thick. If for every epsilon there is a k, big k, such that the ratio of nk plus 1 over nk is less than 1 plus epsilon for all k. So lots and lots and lots of sequences are thick. Examples of thick sequences. Well, obviously the integers, but also the primes, but also, say, third powers, the cubes, but also, say, hundreds powers of primes, and so on. So in particular, you can choose, you can fit into this machine a sequence such as the hundreds or fifth powers of primes, and then you are assured that if H4 is Sophic, there is an infinite sequence of fourth powers of primes, which for each of which you have that, let me see, so there exists, let me write down improved version here. So let this be a thick sequence. And there exists k, and a bijection nk, nk. So nk can be, say, the fifth powers of primes. And for these fifth powers of primes, you have these two rules. And as I said, we haven't shown that this is impossible. But for nk, say, the fifth powers of primes, it is known. It is a result of two different teams of people. Let me write them down in a second. It is known that this would be false. It would lead to contradiction if you allowed not epsilon nk, but rather fewer exceptions, more like nk to the 1/4 or something like that. So what the two ends don't quite meet. This doesn't show that H4 is not Sophic, but this is, I think, a step in the direction, I would hazard to say. Just to give credit where credit is due. Yes? Oh, sorry. Obviously. code that. Thank you. Very, very ashamed. Where do we have the names? On the one hand, there is Glebsky. So note for ni the fifth powers of prime. These so 1 and 2 conjunction is false if so one star is 1 with 1 for how many values here? For, I think, 1 nk minus nk to the 1/5. Don't quote me on that. I think I have it here. Yes, that's right. 1/6 values x. And this is due to Glebsky and to people whose initials are H and R, as I found recently. And according to my bibliography, this is Holden and Robinson. I actually like the Holden-Robinson proof very much. It's using p-adic analysis. Glebsky's proof is shorter and less transparent. But deep down, even though he doesn't use p-adic numbers, it's that. He's using Hensel's lemma without saying so. Of course, means you're doing p-adic analysis in some sense. Very well. Do I have anything else to say? Yes. You might ask, as I said, well, what happens with fewer iterations? First, let me give you a very simple statement. Well, it's a statement that is very easy to prove. I will leave it as an exercise, which is that. So. What happens if you have fewer iterations? So easy to show, easy exercise. In Z modulo nZ, n bigger than a constant, depending only on epsilon, well, let me use delta, why not? Am I using delta or epsilon there? Epsilon. So the two conditions would be impossible. You cannot have them at the same time. If you had 3 iterations, even if you just required these many values, so how do you show that this is impossible? This is a consequence of the fact that H3 is trivial. The fact that H3 is trivial is not so trivial. It requires some wit. It's at the end of Higman's paper, where he credits it to somebody called K.A. Hirsch. But now one can say, it turns out, something that is stronger and weaker than that statement, and that's not so trivial. I will give you the proof at the end if there's time. So theorem B, really more of a proposition. So let n, g be coprime. So f from 0 up to n minus 1 to itself, I will define by f of x equals gx modulo n. So it's not quite the exponential map modulo n, though it looks exactly like that, because exponential map modulo n, of course, is not defined from z modulo nz to itself. It has period n minus 1. But it is very much like that. And notice that that map obeys this with a constant number of mistakes, in fact, 1 mistake. And pretty much the same is true whenever you have a constant number of mistakes. And then one can show that this has to fail, not just a positive number, a positive proportion of all places, but at almost all places. little earth n places. So little earth n means, of course, a quantity. Notation, standard in analytic number theory, but E of n is little O of n if G of n, n goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. So a proportion 0 of all elements can satisfy that if practically, if F is genuinely the, or almost genuinely the exponential map, which is something that obeys these for with at most one mistake. Very well. And this improves also on something in the literature, because it was known to fail for at least a fourth of all values, but not for a proportion one. So this improves on paper by Glebsky, the same Glebsky and Sperlinski. So the main ideas of the two proofs are actually quite simple. Though I will have to describe what I mean in the first case, at least. So, main ideas of proofs. So, in the case of theorem A, it's the fact that Sophic representations, and I will explain what I mean, of an amenable group, and I will also define amenable, are conjugate. Well, so again, this is a fact that is known, and you can find it in different instantiations in Curly and before that in Alexabo. I think it's, yes, it's generally associated to the latter more than the former. It's just that I mention also the former. Because in Alexabo, it's in infinitary language, so to speak. It uses ultra products. So ultra products make several things much more elegant, but I also find them personally a bit hard to they make a paper hard to read for me. I'm still a beginner in the field. For some people, it's the essence of the thing, of course. Here, this is a purely finitary proof. Though it's a bit broken, but in the preprint, we go and fix it. It's not hard to fix. And this actually was used, I will put yet another duo here, in a nice recent paper by Argenteva and Paunescu, which actually helped us refine our preprint. In that, they were using that. No, excuse me. They were using this. But we end up using this version. Very well. So what do we mean by saying that any two Sophic representations of an amenable group are conjugate? We mean that if you have that phi 1 and phi 2 are S delta n Sophic representations of G, and S is large enough, and delta is small enough, then there exists, in terms of the in terms of epsilon, which will be specified, or rather we will see it right away, then there exists a bijection tau from one n to itself, such that it will not quite show that one is conjugate to the other, but almost, such that tau phi 1 s tau inverse x will be phi 2s x for all s in s and almost all one minus for almost all x in 1 up to n. So, well, or if you wish to state this more concisely, the Huffman distance between this map and that map is small. It tends to 0. Very well. Now, that will be the main idea, the main tool in CRMA. It's a known tool. We'll see how to apply it. Perhaps the experts want to start sketching how to apply it to prove CRMA. CRMB has really a very, very simple idea. I will say that CRMB is, once somebody tells you the main idea, it becomes an Olympiad problem and not an IMO problem. It's more of an Ibero-American Olympiad problem. So CRMB, functional recurrence. And I am sure that at least one member of the audience, now that I said Olympiad, will try to prove CRMB before I'm done with my talk. But he's doing email. Very well. All right. So some brief reminders. So let's say that you have finitely generated group G. Then G is called amenable if there exists an infinite sequence of subsets, a chain of subsets, containing the identity such that each of J is barely budged by any element of S. So these are almost invariant subsets. Very well. Let me also define the so-called Bounce-like solitaire group. The Bounce-like solitaire group, just define it when the first parameter is 1. Is defined by, it's a group generated by two elements, A1 and A2, obeying the following rule. So, exercise, this is amenable. Very well. Now, what can one say? It's amenable, hence it's sophic, but it's actually very easy to show explicitly that it's sophic. Very, very, very easy. So how? Let n be such that phi of n, meaning the Euler phi, not these representations, p minus 1 is bigger than 1 minus epsilon n, and n is coprime to m. So this is very easy to achieve. In particular, you could choose n prime. Then we are going to define a sophic representation. Well, actually, can somebody in the audience give me a sophic representation of the Baumstock solitaire group? Can you give me, for S even very, very big, can you give me and delta very, very small. Can you give me a sophic representation, an S delta n sophic representation, or S epsilon n sophic representation of the Baumslag solitaire group? Guys? I just want, say just A1, A2, and short words on that. So define a map sending A1 and A2 two elements of sim n, obeying this rule approximately. Why approximately even? All right. So define phi n, psi n, say, sending b as 1 m, two sim, the group of all permutations of Zen mod n set, which of course is just Cmn. So I want two elements, or I want two bijections from Z mod n Z to itself that satisfy these two rules. That, well, they satisfy just this one rule, A1 inverse, A2, A1 equals A2m. Yes? Hmm? It's actually quite simple. So define this by, well, it will take this map phi n, will take A1 to the map x goes to m minus 1 x, and A2 goes to x goes to x plus 1. Yes. For S given, and then large enough, this is A. And S eta n Sophic representation. Well, O of delta, O of epsilon. Very well. Clear, no? I divide by m, I add 1, I multiply by m, and that's the plus m map. All right. Very, very nice and simple arithmetical maps. So what do we do with that? So suppose H4 is Sophic. Then, by a general principle, so is set for Z direct product H4. So which general principle? Amenable extensions. Of Sophic groups are Sophic. Actually, do you know who this is due to? Kate wasn't able to tell me. And is there, this is much simpler than this. It's a very special case. This is a cyclic extension of a Sophic group is Sophic. Who proved that first? Well, we'll talk about that during the cocktail. Very well. What do I mean exactly by this semi-direct product? So description, a generator. Pick a generator T of Zn mod 4Z, acts, of course, on H4 by conjugation as follows. So A1 goes to A2, i.e., TA1 T minus 1 equals A2. Do I need that, or the exact opposite? No, that's what I mean. And in the same way, it sends A2 to A3, A3 to A4, and A4 to A1. And so that's a well-defined group. So we assume that that's Sophic, right? So let us say that it has an S delta N Sophic representation. So we'll just have it be words of length 3, I think. On A1, A2, A3, A4, AT. Let me say 4. So let phi be a Sophic representation. Well, and if I restrict it to something, it will still be a Suffolk representation, of course. So let me restrict it to the Baumslag solitary group. How am I embedding the Baumslag solitary group here? Well, there are several ways, but I'm just choosing the obvious way. It's when I consider the subgroup generated by A1 and A2 in the Higman group. They obey that rule and no other. Very well, but we already had a Suffolk representation for an arbitrary thing here, for arbitrary epsilon and enlarged enough for the Baumslag solitary group. We had that one, right? Psi n. And we also have that BS12 is amenable. So that Suffolk representation and that one, psi n, have to be conjugate. Meaning what? As I said before, that there exists a taus, a bijection taus, such that phi of n, for every s in s, phi of n s is tau phi bs12 tau inverse x for almost all values. Very well. Now we also have the first rule of the definition, since phi, definition of sophicity. Since phi is an almost homomorphism, and t a1, t minus 1 equals a2, and t4 equals 1, we know that phi of a2 of x is phi of t, phi of a1, phi of t inverse, x, for almost all values of x in 1 up to n. And so, phi n a2 of x equals tau phi bs12 a2 t inverse x, and this is equal to, well, for almost all values of f, t phi inverse t tau phi tau inverse A1, tau phi tau inverse tau t minus 1 x, and this is tau phi tau inverse t psi n A1 tau phi tau inverse t inverse x for almost all values of x. So this is a funny map. tau phi tau inverse t is something that when you conjugate the very simple map A1, the multiplication by m minus 1, by it, you get that you get the map A2. Very well. We also know that phi tau to the fourth has lots of fixed points. You know, because phi tau to the fourth to the x equals phi tau 4 to the x, but tau to the fourth is t to the fourth is the identity, and you can see quickly from the definition that it has to be mapped to something equal to the identity at all points, almost all points. For almost all values of x. And so the same has to be true for the conjugate, obviously. Yes, but then I can easily fix this map I just fix it at all other places. I can declare it to be the identity at all other places. Such that, well, f to the fourth x will be x for all values of x. And you also have that this rule has to be true. Yes, so what does that mean? That means, if I haven't mixed things up, so phi n a2 is, did I do something almost very silly? No, I will define this to be the inverse. So I will have that. Let me see. No, I think this was right. We will have precisely that. When you apply this map F, you take the inverse, no, and you then add one, and then you act with the map again, you get the multiplication by M map. I think you need, sorry, it's the map, the inverse map here. Okay. Bit of fixed notation to be fixed, but it's almost completely all right. And then you have that f of x plus 1 equals m f of x for all, for at least 1 minus epsilon n values of x. Very well, and that's the map you wanted. That's it. All right, I think we have enough time for a very brief sketch of theorem B. Well, it's not really a sketch. I can give it to you in full if you allow me to be a bit fake. So proof, but it can be fixed easily, of theorem B. Because I will behave as the thing that looks very much like the exponential map modulo n, but isn't quite, because it's really exponential map reduced modulo n, we're exactly exponential map modulo n. So let me see. And Google, have you proved theorem B yet? I asked you to half an hour ago. It's very, very simple if you allow it that little bit of fakeness. I had it here. Where did my page go? 15. Here it is. So suppose that the map G, 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 X, so G is a generator of set mod and set. Let me the prime modulus just to simplify. Of course, in general, you can work with general n. As I say, it's a very slightly fake proof. So, and I will be working modulo p generally rather than reducing modulo p. So suppose that this is true for a positive proportion. Then there exists a bounded k, well, bounded by something depending on that proportion, such that this equation holds for x and for x plus k for a positive proportion of all k, of all x. This is an elementary fact that can be easily checked. It's also a special case of Poincaré recurrence. Baby Poincaré, if you wish. Very well. It's true for any fact. If a fact is true for one-tenth of all integers, and there is a constant, a bounded constant, such that the statement will be true for both x and x plus k for a proportion at least 1% of all integers. See? Slightly fake numbers, but the idea is that one. So we should have g x plus k equals x plus k equals, well, what would x be? It would be g x plus k. So we write y to be g to the gx, and so we get that g to the y to the g to the k is g to the y plus k for a propositive, for a positive proportion of all, a fixed constant proportion of all y in z mod pz. Very well. But by the same argument as before, well, what we said before, additively is true multiplicatively. So again, by Poincaré, there is a bounded L such that this thing here is true for both y and ly for a proportion of all y. So we write z to be y to the g to the y, and we obtain, it seems, that z plus k l g to the k equals z to the l plus k for a positive proportion of all z. Right? But that cannot be the case. Why can't that be the case? Well, g is fixed, k is fixed, l is fixed. So this is a fixed polynomial equation. It's going to have only a bounded number of roots. It cannot have, you know, and it's non-trivial. It's going to have a bounded number of roots. It cannot be true for a positive proportion of all z. Of course, there was a slightly fixed spot right about here, in that this is not really a well-defined map from z mod nz to itself. Right, I had a reduction. But you can fix that in a page. And the basic idea of this proof holds. I tried. It doesn't work. Try it. I mean, it would be wonderful if you could make it work. But all right. So in that note, I've said all I wanted to say. This is probably just a small step in the direction of showing that the Higman group is non-suffix, something that I think is highly likely. But I hope this will at least start a discussion on how to proceed to show the existence of non-Sophie groups. Yes, that's our theorem A. Theorem B was a small lateral discussion, which is, I mean, people have been trying to prove this before because these exponential maps are relevant in the context of pseudo-random number generators, for instance. So that's why there was a paper with Glebsky and Chmielinski before. Though since it was the same Glebsky, perhaps Glebsky was onto something as well. But I haven't met him. So on that note, I finish my talk.